Okay, so let's. The topic of today's lecture is to study about limits of solar energy conversion, and this is a topic that has perplexed people since the very early ages. So here's a picture of an Egyptian priest or a priya, and he's trying to convert sunlight into whatever, capture sunlight into a flask of can, and people have been always concerned about what would be the efficiency of this conversion. If you want to convert sunlight into electricity, or if you want to even convert sunlight into, for example, heating up water and then driving up a plant, so what's the efficiency of that conversion? And this was an intense topic of interest back when people wanted to use these things for satellites, and the efficiencies were really low, but they wanted to at least gauge how high they'll become in the future. And many people, some of them famous people, have tried to contribute, pitch in, and figure out what this efficiency would be. So today's lecture I'm going to summarize, and we'll do a kind of a demo as well, and try to figure out what these efficiencies look like. Right, so there are different limits. There's a Shockley. The most prominent one is this limit, Shockley-Queisser limit. You heard from Eli on Monday. So he also has contributed into this, and his limit is called T.J. Yablonovich limit, or T.J. Eli's limit. And then there's these two things are more things which come from thermodynamics, and we'll discuss this today as well. So actually, let me take a poll. How many people think, what do you think is the maximum efficiency of solar energy conversion? How many people think more than 90? Like any hypothetical cell, think more than 90? Okay. Any reason or just intuition? Huh? Okay. Is that reachable? I mean, even there's a thermodynamic limit with 95, but can a solar energy conversion reach that? So we'll find out by then. It's a good question, keep in mind. We'll discuss, can you really reach, you quoted that number 95, right? Let's see if we can reach that. How many people think between 80 and 90? Just two? Okay. And you have any specific reason or just intuition? Uh-huh. Okay. Anybody else have any specific numbers you might have heard, overheard, or browsed upon it somewhere? What would be like if you have a multi-junction cell, it has infinite cells connected, one after another, what would be the limit of that? So each cell you have infinite material system available for you to play. You can make each cell of a different band gap.
Somewhere around 80.
81?
Somewhere around 80.
Okay, somewhere around 80. Okay, let's take a look. Okay, so let's see who's right. We are rooting for, what's your name? Huh? Ben. Okay, so we're rooting for Ben. Ben is aiming for 95. So this is. Actually, this has nowadays become a battle cry for people who are doing research in PV. So earlier it used to be for satellite, people wanted to know why, what would be the maximum achievable efficiency. But now it comes into play very effectively in this dollar per watt game. So this is, what this chart is plotting is efficiency versus the cost, right? So if you have a higher efficiency, if you see over here, if you have a higher efficiency and you have more dollars, you can even if you're charging more dollars per meter square, you're still going to be on the same dollar per watt meter square. So if you have a more efficient cell, you can essentially charge a lot for it. And most of the silicon technology, crystalline silicon technology, which is what people call as a first generation technology, that tended to be on this curve. So people were able to raise efficiency, but the cost went high as well. So the dollar per watt number, it's shown over here, is $3.5 per watt, but it's more close to a module price of $2 per watt. So this is what was called the first generation of PV. The second generation PV, which happened really in the last decade, was these low efficiency cells, but they used to cost you know, much cheaper. For example, CATL, which is first solar cell, or a lot of these CIGS my type of cell, or amorphous silicon cells. So they tend to be in this second generation silicon technology, where you have efficiencies of, you know, 10%, but you're going to cost less than $100 per meter square. So again, you now bring it down to this slope, which is $1 per watt. But now what the third generation PV, or what is being popularized as third generation PV, is to go to these really high efficiencies, and probably not as cheap as the second generation of the thin film cell, or probably as expensive as the crystalline silicon cell, but go to really high efficiency. So efficiency has really become the name of the game for third generation of photovoltaics. And plotted here are, you know, this limit, which we'll just derive, called the Shockley-Queisser limit. So it gives you a limit of around 32% for efficiencies when you have a concentration of 1 cent. But if you look at what people are aiming for, everybody wants to exceed that Shockley-Queisser limit. And there are some other limits over there, thermodynamic limits. And so efficiency, or you know, finding what range we are allowed, has become very important, and figuring out ways to essentially exceed that limit. But first we need to understand, you know, where is this Shockley-Queisser limit coming from. So to break the rules of the game, first you need to understand if you want to break the law, you need to first understand the integrities of the law very well. So we need to understand where that limit is coming from, well, if you want to exceed it, right? So what I want to use for the derivation is just two very basic, we are not going to use anything related to PN junction. In fact, you know, I'm going to use just two things. One is Planck's law, given by Max Planck. It says that the intensity, or the spectral irradiance, is given as a function of frequency by this formula, where it's proportional to the cube of the frequency, and then it has this exponential term, which causes it to decay as you increase the frequency, keep on increasing the frequency. And it has a temperature dependence, which essentially comes from this Bose-Einstein statistics that all photons have to obey, or all bosons, or all Bose-Einstein particles have to obey. And this gives me the intensity. If I need to find the number of photons, so I'm going to divide that intensity by the energy of each photon, which is given by E equal to h mu, and that will give me the number of photons. So that's the first thing I'm going to use. Okay. The second thing I'm going to use is again something which we all know from our. The second thing I'm going to use is something we know from our high school physics, that is the laws of thermodynamics. So what's the first law of thermodynamics? It's energy is equal to the work done, denoted by W, plus the heat, right? So it's the law of energy conservation. The second law of thermodynamics is that any process which involves energy conversion would lead to a net entropy generation. So whenever you are doing an energy conversion, you'll have some amount of entropy which will be generated. At best, it can be zero, but it has to be greater than or equal to zero. You can't do an energy conversion and have net entropy decrease, right? There's also a third law of thermodynamics, which we don't need, but does anybody remember that? Yeah, so third law of thermodynamics is, what's your name?
Sam.
Do you just remember it from high school, or, I would have forgotten.
I remember from the whole of thermodynamics.
All right, so Sam has very good memory, he remembers. Third law of thermodynamics is that entropy at 0 Kelvin is 0, right? But we don't need that for this derivation. So we need Planck's law, and we need the two laws of thermodynamics, right? Everybody gets these two things? Okay, so now there are multiple ways I can approach this problem. So I can, you know, I'm giving you three props over here, and each gives a different direction which we can, you know, a different methodology we can apply to essentially calculate the maximum efficiency, right? So I can do it this way, which is look at my p-n junction, derive an equation for my p-n junction, try to maximize that I times V, and you know, derive my efficiency that way. I can look at from a cell design point of view and say that where are my losses occurring? Am I losing things? Am I reflecting sunlight? Are the recombination processes happening? Is there things being lost in the top diffusion layer where carriers are not collected? So these are all, you know, these are two very valid ways of looking at it. But for today's discussion, I'm going to mostly use this way that just let's look at the spectrum. So we can either look at as like being a black body at the temperature of the sun. So we can either approximate the spectrum as that being of a black body at 6000 Kelvin, or we can actually take the actual shape of the spectrum, which is the AM 1.5G spectrum, and we'll just say whatever is above the band gap of my semiconductor of my choosing will get absorbed completely, and whatever is below the band gap is going to completely get reflected off, right? So that's a fair assumption to make, right? So I'm going to build on these, I'm going to fill this up as we move along, but for now let's just look at this process where I'm going to estimate the efficiency by this way, that whatever is above the band gap generates electron and hole pair and it's collected. Whatever is below the band gap is essentially just completely filtered out or removed from the system. So doing this way, the way I'll, let's say I choose a band gap of 1.1 eV. So this is plotting as a function of wavelength. So higher wavelength means higher wavelengths means over here that the wavelength which is higher than this has lower energy as compared to the band gap, and the lower wavelength means higher energy. So whatever is at a cutoff wavelength, which gives me the band gap, whatever is on the right hand side will essentially just completely leak out, and whatever is on the left hand side will get completely absorbed, right? So the corresponding wavelength for silicon, which has a band gap of say 1.12 eV, would be somewhere over here. So it's around 1100 nanometers. So whatever is greater than wavelength than that, that completely goes through the system. It's transparent through the system, so it leaks out. And whatever are the wavelengths which are below this is what is absorbed in my silicon, right? So that's pretty clear to understand, right? And what is the energy it's going to get collected at? It's going to get collect. What is the maximum energy it can get collected at? The band gap, right? So, assuming that you cannot collect hot carriers, I mean, there are people who want to do that, but assuming that if you're generating hot carriers, they just get relaxed in the silicon, you're going to just collect that energy at the maximum potential difference of equal to the band gap. So if we do that, what should be the efficiency that I should get? Any guesses? Should it be the Shockley-Coiser limit, or how many people think that would be the Shockley-Coiser limit? One. Okay. All right. Let's see. Right, so I can take this spectrum or integrate it, or I can take I can integrate this with the solar spectrum, and or I can estimate the spectrum by using Planck's law, and I'll say my sun is essentially a black body at 6000 Kelvin, and this is a very idealized scenario where, you know, I assume my cell to be of this shape as well. It's like a circular disk, so it can absorb the sun from all directions, and my cell is at 0 Kelvin, right? So I can essentially integrate all the photon absorbs, all the photons which have a cutoff of equal to the wavelength, everything equal to the band gap, everything in energy above that will get absorbed. And then I can integrate this to get me the overall input power, right? And this is how, in fact, the Shockley-Queisser paper also starts, and that's how they describe this limit as well. But the limit that comes from this is approximately 44, exactly 44.8. It occurs at a band gap of 1.2 eV around. But this is higher than the Shockley-Queisser limit. Shockley-Queisser limit is only 32%, or 33%, right? So what did we miss in this analysis? Yeah, Dan. Okay, so what would happen if I put it to 300? So you're saying if I increase it to 300 Kelvin, my efficiency would decrease. But the number of photons I'm going to get absorbed are the same, right? So, okay. Can you elaborate on it? What's your name? Yeah. So, does everybody agree with him? So, if I have a cell which is at a particular temperature, it's not going to just absorb, but it's going to radiate energy as well, right? So, that's what is missing from this analysis, that I ignored this. For every process, there's going to be a reverse process, and even if I assume no defects, nothing else, this would be a fundamental process that would be happening in my semiconductor, right? That if I have generation, I would have correspondingly a recombination process as well, right? But the tough part is how do I calculate it? Because let's say there's an electron and hole recombining to generate this photon, but this photon, if it's generated in the cell, it can get reabsorbed, right? Because this photon, let's say it was generated by electron here and a hole here, it had energy equal or even slightly higher than the band gap. Then it can get reabsorbed again. And then it maybe emits out again, but then it can get reabsorbed again, right? So how do I, the problem that people had at that time when Shockley-Queisser wrote this paper was to how to calculate this net rate of recombination, or these different modes of recombination. So that is what the real, my best part of the paper was, and I'll tell you how it was done, and we'll do it the same way. So this is that paper from 1961, and that paper is titled "The Detailed Balance Limit." Right. And detailed balance is actually a principle which is used in math and in thermodynamics sometimes. What it says is that if you have two processes, A and B, and they are in equilibrium, so the net rate at which A is transferring to B is equal to the net rate at which B is transferring to A. Right? So that's the argument that they used. And it's actually a pretty neat way that this paper derived it. And I was I was listening to a talk which this other second author on the paper, Hans Queisler, gave. And he was telling that this paper was essentially initially rejected because I'll show you the argument, but it's a very simple argument to make. And when they made it, people said, what are you guys doing? This is just thermodynamics. What's new in this paper? Right? And it was initially rejected, and they had to when papers get rejected, the first thing you have to do is to admire the reviewers and praise them for all the things they have pointed it out. Anybody who has published papers and gone through review, it's like that. So they essentially added additional explanation to explain why people were not able to reach this limit, and what other people had done and how their work was different from it. And in the first 5 years it was published, it was cited maybe less than 10 times, I think 8 times. These are kind of papers that are called sleeping beauties. They don't get cited for a long year, and some of you might have some papers like that as well, which you are not getting cited as frequently, but nowadays it gets cited at least few times a week. It has more than 2000 or something citations. So let's look at the paper first. So what are the assumptions they made? So said, let's look at the concentration of one sun, because their funding said, let's look at the concentration of one sun. It's very easy to look at higher concentration as well, but just like the concentration of sunlight is equal to what you get from one sun. You're not concentrating it further. They assume that the sun and the cell were black bodies. Sun in this case to be at 6000 Kelvin, the cell at 300 Kelvin. Right, very reasonable assumptions to make. They assume that the absorption is step function, which is, we also made that assumption that everything above the band gap get absorbs completely, and everything below the band gap is not absorbed at all. Another assumption they made was the mobility of the carriers was infinite. So if you're generating something, that will have no problem in reaching the contacts. So there will be no problem related to mobility. Now the only loss mechanisms they assumed was essentially radiative recombination. So now how do I calculate the radiative recombination? I already explained, can you close? So I explained that it's difficult to do it from the semiconductor side because there are competing processes happening. There's emission, there's reabsorption and so on. So instead, the argument that they gave was, let's place the cell. So my cell is at temperature T cell, which is, you know, 300 Kelvin in their case. Now let's place it in a cavity. Okay, let's place it inside a black body, which is at the same temperature as well. Okay, and further, let's not apply any voltage on the cell. So there's no current passing through. The carriers are in equilibrium. The temperature is in equilibrium, there's no voltage applied, so the cell is in equilibrium, right? So now in this case, how do I calculate the net radiative recombination, right? So you want to take, okay. So the way I can do that is I can say that this is a black body which is surrounding my cell, and it's going to give out the radiation which is given by the Planck's law, right? And that amount of radiation is going to get absorbed by my cell. So now, whatever is getting absorbed by the cell, it also has to, by the detailed balance principle, it also has to emit that out, right? So it will emit that out, and the net emission is going to be that net absorption. And this net emission, the only process where it can come from is the radiative recombination, right? So I'm looking at it from a system level, and I'm saying that, okay, the cell is placed here. It absorbing all the spectrum coming from this surrounding. So it has to emit out that amount of spectrum as well, right? So it's going to, at each frequency, it has to emit out that spectrum. And that spectrum has to come from the radiative recombination, because I've assumed everything else to be ideal. There's no voltage applied, there are no defects in the semiconductor. So that net recombination has to come from my radiative recombination, right? So that is the argument they said. So the net radiative recombination at 0 volt is going to be what is getting absorbed. And what is getting absorbed, I can use my, you know, my good friend Planck's law. I've written it over here in terms of energy instead of frequency. So instead of h mu, I've replaced it by E. And I'm just integrate it from all the energies starting from the band gap. That's the minimum energy of the photon which can come out, and then going all the way to infinity, right? So this is going to give me the net recombination at 0 voltage applied, right? Is that clear? Right? I mean, there's nothing, if you tell the argument, it's very easy to understand why this argument was made, but it was a difficult argument to make at that time, given the state of things, right? So this is the net recombination, or the net radiative recombination coming at 0 volt. But as you all might know, you don't operate the cell at 0 volt. You operate it at a particular voltage, right? So now the next thing is, how do I calculate this recombination at any other voltage? So they made another approximation, and I'm going to use a little bit of semiconductor theory. So net radiative recombination rate in a semiconductor, it's proportional to the total number of multiplication of the total number of electrons and holes. So if you have say a semiconductor which has more more holes, usually the number of electrons decrease and this net radiative recombination rate remains the same. So this NP, or this product of the number of electrons and holes, this gives me the net recombination rate. And how it behaves with the temperature is again something we'll discuss. How it behaves with applied voltage is that it increases exponentially with the applied voltage. So if you apply a particular voltage across the semiconductor, your Fermi level split, and the way it translates to this NNP product is that this NP product, it increases exponentially as this function of the voltage. So then they made this argument, so okay, so we know the net recombination rate at 0 volt because we have calculated that by equating that to thermal equilibrium and equating that to what we are getting absorbed. But now if I need to do it at another voltage, I'm going to use some of my knowledge of semiconductors. And Shockley, by you can call him the fathers of semiconductors, so people won't debate if he says that, if it's given by this formula. So it's the net recombination rate at any other voltage is going to be given by what was my recombination rate at zero, and it's going to rise exponentially as a function of voltage. Okay, so these are the only, this is my recombination rate at any voltage. Now I'm in a good position to calculate my efficiency. Right, so what is the amount of current I get? Amount of current I get is the number of photons that I absorb above the band gap minus the number of photons which are emitted out in the term, or I'm going to subtract the number of carriers which recombine and get emitted out as photons. And that is given by this neat equation, which is my recombination rate at zero voltage, and then it rises exponentially as a function of voltage. Right? So if anybody of you has a semiconductor background, this actually is close to what a diode equation is also. It's this would be your generation current, and this would be your exponential diode current. But they didn't use any PN junction theory to derive it, any knowledge of diode to derive it. You can derive it from a principle of just thermodynamic equilibrium as well, right? So the net power out is now essentially my that current as a function of voltage into the voltage, and now I can calculate my efficiency, right? So that is what they did, and this is how it looks like if you assume it to be a black body at, if you assume the sun to be a black body at 6000 Kelvin, so you get a maximum efficiency of close to 30%, and that's what their paper said as well, that the efficiency is 30% at 300 Kelvin, right? And if you increase the temperature, you see that this blue curve is for 300 Kelvin. If I'm increasing the temperature, this is 400 Kelvin, this is 500 Kelvin, so this efficiency is dropping, right? Why is it dropping? Huh?
More recombination.
That's completely correct. How can you explain more recombination?
Because of the higher temperature,
right? So the way we derive this recombination rate was by assuming it to be a black body, right? So now if my cell is at a higher temperature, this black body is at a higher temperature, and then this integration of that Planck's law, my net radiative recombination from the cell is going to increase, right? So that's a very intuitive way to understand why efficiency of the cell drops as you increase the temperature, right? Yes?
So when you said that it's kind of like a step function, mm-hmm. in the sense that any energy level less than this is not going to be absorbed, is going to be absorbed. Because it's a
Yeah, yeah. So the step function is with respect to the absorption function, right? But the incident power, or the number of photons which are coming in, right? How I calculated, so there are two things there, right? One is everything above EG gets absorbed, right? But the number of photons above EG which are incoming are determined by the spectrum of the sun, right? And this over here is assuming, this thing over here assume that the sun is a black body at 6000 Kelvin. So it has that Planck's law distribution in terms of the spectrum coming from the sun.
So you said that, you know, the reason it feels right is because of recombination, maybe increasing combination, like what we were just talking about.
What happened on the right? That is when I increase the temperature, that is from blue to green to red. But you're saying, why does it decrease if I increase the band gap? Is that what you're asking? If you go right, why does it decrease? Right? So if you look at this curve, it looks, again, close to a black body radiation as well, right? But it's not coming from the black body, but it's actually, in a way that spectrum of the black body was like this, right? So we're going to do a demo here where you understand it better, but let's say just at the spectrum of over here. So if I go to higher band gap, that is if I decrease my cutoff wavelength, right? So I'm going to lose out a lot of my spectrum. So if I increase my band gap, right, a lot of the spectrum will just go through without getting absorbed, right? But I'm going to absorb that at a high voltage, versus if I decrease my band gap, all of it will get absorbed, but it will get extracted at a very low energy because my band gap is low. So that's the reason why this curve has this profile where it efficiency decreases if you decrease the band gap, right? And then because you're absorbing all of it, but you're extracting it at a very low voltage, their output current. Over here, when you're increasing your band gap, a lot of your spectrum is just leaking through, so you're not absorbing any of it.
Anymore. Is it also due to the fact that there's less higher energy, photons?
Yes, yes. So that's why the shape of this kind of resembles the shape of your spectrum. Yeah. So that number of photons which are available is going to determine by the spectrum. So you can make like a band gap, a cell with a band gap of say 5 volt, but it won't give you any current because there are no photons available at 5 volt, right? Or very few photons available at 5 volt. So this curve is assuming that my sun was a black body at 6000 Kelvin. I can also take, instead of taking the sun to be black body, I can actually take the real spectrum of the sun. So this is assuming that the AM 1.5G spectrum, and this gives a slightly higher efficiency. It gives, if you zoom in over here, it predicts a maximum efficiency of around a little more than 33%, or around 32.5 for silicon. And both silicon and gallium arsenide, they're situated very close to this peak efficiency, right? But not at the maximum, but very close. Okay, so actually this is a good point to go and delve into your question, which was related to you know, how the shape of this efficiency curves comes about.